Belen, happy birthday, Belen. We love to see you very soon back again. I hope next Sunday. And for Hallo Ella, what they say. And for all the other ones that are watching a little bit later online, God bless you all. Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babies and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the path of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
Amen. Father, fix our hearts, fix our thoughts, fix our minds on your word and upon Christ Jesus, our Savior. Fix our hearts, Father, fix them through your Spirit. Remind us constantly of that wondrous gospel, the gospel that is within us, the gospel that we proclaim. Remind us, Lord, of the things of this world and to leave the things of the world away, to walk away, to push it away and to concentrate solely upon you, giving you the worship, giving you the honor, giving you the praise and giving you the thanks. And help us to encourage one another, not just to leave one another by the wayside, but to be brothers and sisters in the faith. And upholding one another, encouraging one another. Father, may this service be to your glory, to your honor, to your praise, be worshipped, be adored, and be lifted up in Jesus' name.
Oh,
Time doing the service. If you wish to give online, the ones who are joined us and will join us online, the item code is up there from the bank. Amen. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Triune God, Sovereign, All Powerful, Almighty, thank you so much for this new day that you granted us. Thank you for your mercy this morning. Thank you for grace. Thank you for everyone that's here, presential this morning, and for everyone that is joining us online. Thank you for all these brothers and sisters all over the world who follow your commandment to not to forget the Assembly of God on Sunday. What a blessing. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sovereign God, for saving us. Thank you that you extended irresistible grace towards us, that we are chosen, that we are forgiven. Thank you so much. Oh Lord God, forgive us from our sins. And to those who don't know you or are gone astray, may you grant repentance to them, Lord. We do so many things wrong during the week, during the day. And it is because we are still sinners saved by grace. And you are holy. You are perfect. You are the Almighty God. And we thank you that you have sent the only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus. May we be good bond servants to you this week, every day. Our Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, High Priest, our King. May we serve you. May we lay down again every day our lives for you, Lord, and have no other gods before you. That you are our number one. As we learn, this is the only way to walk in the Spirit. May we read more. May we pray more. May we follow you, Jesus, our teacher. Your ways are the right ways. May we do not trust in institution and in other people. May we just simply trust in you and your word and turn away from evil and and just trust you that we do our best according to the word that you left us. And even then, we make wrong decisions and choices. We know that you're sovereign, you know the future, you straighten out our path, Lord. We thank you for the new day. We thank you for a new week. May we don't think of ourselves all the time. May we think of others first. To truly lay down our lives for others and to love one another. You made us for your own glory. May we worship you every day, at work, in school, wherever we are, so you can receive the glory, praise, and honor. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Father, we come to your word this morning. I pray that by your Spirit and through your Spirit, you would open up our eyes, you would open up our hearts, you would open up our minds, you would open up our intellect, you would open up us as individuals, as brothers and sisters in the faith. And Father God, I just pray that as I hear this word this morning, may I just be the spokesperson, may I just be the mouthpiece, the messenger. But you are the message. You are the message. And as we gather around your word, whatever it is that I get wrong, that I entangle, may you disentangle and make it clear in our hearts and in our minds, that we may leave this place more educated, more aware, more praiseful, more worshipful, to reflect your glory. May we be the lights in this dark, dark world, and bring the light and the truth of the gospel into such an evil world that's dark and surrounded by darkness and wallows in the darkness. May we be the lights that you've called us to be. May we stand up for Jesus. May we stand firm on your word and your truth by the power of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Yes. Evil days we live in, eh? We don't know what's going to happen from one day to the next. We're going through the book of Galatians at the moment, so if you wish the Bible, oh, you can on the cover. If you'd like to turn to Galatians, we're in chapter 6. Part 28, for those of you that are following along. Would you like the Bible? No, you're okay. You want? You'd like them? Get them. It's going to be on the screen anyway, but it's some people prefer to look it up. We're in Galatians 6, 6 to 9. Paul's letter to the churches in Galatia. And just to, for those of you that are visiting us, to give you a very quick resume, the Apostle Paul was their pastor, left the churches to go and carry on with his missionary journeys, and while he was away, they started listening to other teachings and other teachers, and started falling away from the faith, and this letter was written to them basically to tell them to get their act together. And it's actually, the tone of the letters we've seen is, in quite a lot of places, quite angry, quite desperate. And other places in the letter, he's appealing to them as brothers, like, come on. So we continue today from chapter 6, verse 6 to verse 9. Let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. It's an important passage what we're reading this morning. And it's important that we spend time in going into this word. Because this is one of the great passages which we've heard a lot. Those have come out of certain church movements, but it's a great passage that the false teachers use all the time. The reaping and the sowing and the due season. And we've all heard that, and the way that they put it across to you. So this morning we're going to read it in context, so how Paul actually meant it to come through to the people. So Paul's letter spends a great deal arguing, doesn't he? He spends a great deal arguing that the believers are freed from the law. Most of this letter has been about the law and being free in Christ. That is God's gift of faith, as with Abraham. That nothing, no laws, no ceremonies can add to salvation. And we know that the Judaizers were the ones that were saying you need to do this, you need circumcision, you need to do this and that, and keep certain ceremonies. And Paul was all the time saying no. It's Christ alone, it's faith alone, it's grace alone, it's scripture alone, it's to the glory of God alone. And we could wrongly conclude then that we're free from obligations to one another, because there's no more law. Galatians 6 is where Paul outlines to us what it means to live by the Spirit. He said that, hasn't he? Walk in the Spirit, live in the Spirit. So we've been through that. It's kind of his instructions to how a true believer should conduct their life. This is practical stuff. This would be like, we would probably say, this is where the rubber hits the road. This is the nuts and bolts. This is where we can actually learn from what Paul wrote to the Galatians, we can still learn from it today. That's the wonder of God's word. It's the instructions of how true believers to behave and to conduct their lives in regard to loving one another. Fellowship with the brethren. That's what it's all about. And this is one of the biggest things that is twisted or ignored in churches today. In order to combat this potential error, Paul shows us that life in the Spirit will mean a life of serving. We know that Christ came as a servant king. He said, didn't he, I've come to what, serve, not be served. Why is it then that his disciples think that we should be served when he came to serve? We've got it a little bit around the wrong way. And we've been previously reading that in Galatians in chapter 5, back in chapter 5, verse 13. In all of Galatians, Paul's contrasting the way in the flesh, which includes the fleshy things like circumcision and so forth, but he's been comparing and contrasting that with the way of the heart, the way of a regenerate soul, the way of putting the fruits into use. But now he's focusing in on the individual believer. This is from the churches, and now he's writing to the believer. In verse 6, he says this, let him who is taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. Now, passages like this are important. Yeah, to be honest, they're awkward for me, for a preacher, a teacher, a pastor, because it's an awkward part of a passage for me. And you'll find out why. But the wonderful thing about doing expository preaching is that you can't dodge the things that are difficult. You have to go through it. You can't say, well, we're going through Galatians, but we're missing to get out. No, we're going to go through it, and we're going to see what was meant. The context, that's what's important, the context. To whom it was written, why it was written, the purpose of it's written, and the application of why it was written. The context of this is actually a warning. It's a warning to the reluctance of some to provide for the physical welfare of their pastors, of their teachers, and of all those that teach them. And Paul makes this quite clear, this is a matter of self-deception. You're deceiving yourselves. Why? Why is he writing this? Because those who hold back from proper support of their pastors are trying to cheat God. They want the spiritual benefit from their teaching, but they're not prepared to set a realistic value on it. It's true, isn't it? we go to the supermarket and buy 20 euros of junk food, which is only going to last you a few minutes, technically, in and out of the body. We come to church and we sit down and listen to a preaching or a teaching which could benefit your whole life and throw a couple of euros in. That's what it's worth to you. That's what it's saying. That's what Paul's trying to say. They value more highly their own enrichment than any proper payment to the men who provide them the spiritual benefit. They set a higher value, let's put it on this, a higher value on material wealth than their spiritual wealth. Martin Luther wrote this, and I'll quote from his commentary. He says, quote, "These passages are all meant to benefit us ministers. I must say, I do not find much pleasure in explaining these verses. I am made to appear as if I'm speaking for my own benefit. We have come to understand why it is necessary to repeat the admonition of this verse. When Satan cannot suppress the preaching of the gospel by force, he tries to accomplish his purpose by striking the ministers of the gospel with poverty. He curtails their income to such an extent that they are forced out of the ministry because they cannot live by the gospel. Without ministers to proclaim the word of God, the people will go wild like savage beasts. Paul's admonition that the hearers of the gospel share all good things with their pastors and teachers is certainly in order." Unquote. Martin Luther. We all need to be taught. We all need to be taught and instructed in the correct manner. We need to buy materials. I need to buy books. I need to belong to certain societies. Thankfully, I've got a job, so I can pay them. What if I didn't? The church can't support me. The doors would be closed. There'd be no more church here. Even the most revered and respected theologians today pay respects to those that they were mentored by and they sat under. They thank them for the time that they put into them. As well as all the writings we have from the past, the church fathers, the martyrs, and some of the spiritual greats that we can still learn from. But here Paul is talking about those who are teaching them. So let's now flip back to where Paul is. Let's flip back to the church in Galatia. We can recall that just prior to this, in this letter, Paul was talking about helping out with one another, yeah? He's been going on about that for a little bit. Helping with one another's what? Burdens. Isn't it a burden when you're broke?
Yeah.
Burden. Remember, this was a relatively new faith. Christianity was relatively new. It was 30 years old. So these were first generation teachers. Paul and the other apostles were first generation teachers. Therefore, if you go back to this time in Galatia, you can understand that those who became Christians now were teachers, maybe, that they had been put out, they had been ostracized from family. They've been taken away from friends. They've probably been kicked out of the synagogue. They've probably been sacked at work because they were Christians, no longer Jews, or even accepted towards the Gentiles that had idol worship. But now you're one of these new Christians. They want nothing to do with you. So they'd lost all their income. They'd lost everything. They'd lost their homes, their friends, their families. Everything had been taken away from them. Their community, if you look into the times like that, the community would have classed them as the lowest of the low. The village, the town, wherever they lived, would have nothing else to do with them. So that's what Paul is talking about in context. But as we just read from Martin Luther, it's still valid today. Churches can't stay open if they're not supported. We can't stay open. We don't get no help from the government, from the taxman, no nothing. This church is solely open because of the people who give to the work here. If the people stop giving to the work here, the door closes. And that's only a handful of people here. So, glory to God. Good teachers, good pastors, good preachers invest a lot of time and effort into ensuring that they are able to give their best to those who are being taught. It takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of effort. For me, just for a 40-minute sermon, I probably spend 20 hours a week or more, just in preparation, 20 hours. I don't get paid for that 20 hours. That's half a working week. But it's, you do it because you love the Lord. You do it because I love you guys and I love the church and I love the work that he does. But I got this little picture of an iceberg I found on the internet. There you go. It's a bit like that. That's the bit you see, but that's what goes on underneath. It's a lot of effort, a lot of work, but I love it. So Paul now is encouraging his readers, as he encourages us today, because we are readers of his words, to give them respect and to basically do good to them. Just be good to them. A gift, maybe. I don't know how it was done in them days. But basically to acknowledge their commitment and the time to those who teach. We all know there are many pastors today who receive great financial gifts. They receive great financial reward, usually for teaching falsely. We see them floating around in the big cars and the big houses and the jet planes and everything else, but they're the false teachers because they tickle the ears and everyone loves what they say. They're telling you everything's going to be great, everything's going to be all right. Let's pay some more money. And God said he's going to, we get to that now with the due harvest and the reaping and sowing. But there are so many others, as myself, that receive nothing, but we serve from a heart of love, a heart of devotion, due to the calling of their lives. It's what we call serving the brothers. Fellowship, loving one another. That's why we do it, we're serving. In verse 7, I'm going to read 7 and 8 together, because they go together. It would be right to break them up. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will reap of the flesh, reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. There's a warning there, isn't there? Big warning that we've probably skipped over so many times. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. And Paul is still referring to the provision towards his teachers. Sowing and reaping applies to every part of our lives. We know that. That's a law. And not just to those who teach, but Paul is again putting it in front of their eyes. The fact that God sees, God hears, and God knows all the intentions and persuasions of your hearts and your souls. Is God sovereign? Yes, he is. Is God everywhere at all times? Yes, he is. Does God know your thoughts, your motives, your actions, and your deeds? Yes, he does. So he knows what you're withholding. For he's seeing, he sees it, he understands it. And he's saying, don't be deceived, God's not mocked. God's not stupid. He sees. Who gives the seed in the first place? 2 Corinthians 9, verse 10. Tells us, doesn't it? Now may he who supplies what? Seed to the sower. He, in capital, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food, supply and multiply the seed that you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. Fruits of your righteousness. Here we go. Not fruits, full stop. Not you're going to have your barns overflowing with Mercedes-Benz, chocolate, money, holidays. No. Fruits carries on of your righteousness. Righteousness can only come from doing good deeds for God, not for being materially blessed. If God supplies us with the seed needed to produce a harvest of grain, he certainly will supply and multiply the resources needed to produce a full harvest of what? Good deeds, the fruit of your righteousness. He always fulfills his promise to replenish generosity. This principle has application beyond giving and supporting ministers. We know that, teachers and ministers. It has a general application in life. Basically, what we would say is, you only get out what you put in. Yeah, try and tell our kids that when they're younger, when they're trying to do their homework. You only get out what you put in. If you don't study, then you're not going to get results, eh? It's we would call a no-brainer, but it takes a little bit of time. I was a teenager once as well. Paul's not promoting some law of spiritual karma that ensures that we will get good when we do good, or we'll get bad when we do bad. If that was such an absolute spiritual law, we'd all be damned to hell with no hope. There is none. Thankfully, that's not what Paul's saying. Instead, Paul simply relates the principle of sowing and reaping to the way we manage our resources before the Lord. Who gave you the resources? We come right back to the beginning again, don't we? He gives seed to the sower. God. Who gives you a heartbeat? God. Who gives you breath in your lungs? God. We can't do nothing without him. Yet we want to keep everything for ourselves. All about me. It's all about me. I've worked hard for that. I deserve that. Really? Really? You could be struck down tomorrow. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. This phrase is one of the most misquoted out-of-text verses that we know. I think I'm probably right in saying, yeah? We've all heard it, but today used by so many people. Basically, it goes along this, doesn't it? Put your cash in and get some more out. Like God's a great big cash machine. It's like one of these holes in the walls, you know, put in your thing and get some more out. Interesting, actually, when I was on the fired up my PC, I use Bible Gateway quite often to get the scriptures. And the second one down from the top was this one. God gives seed to sowers. This is talking about Corinthians 9:10, yeah? Let this come right at the top. God gives seed to sowers. So it's accurate to say that if you're short of seed, which is finances, then you're not sowing like you should. God will always see to it that sowers have money to abound in every good work. Andrew Womack Ministries. False teacher. Twist scripture. Look at that. He's even added to it. Finances. It's nothing about finances. Seeds of your righteousness. Fruits of your righteousness unto God. Nothing about money. Paul is not speaking materialistically, he is speaking spiritually. The Bible is a spiritual book, therefore we are to read it and understand it in a spiritual manner, not in a material manner, and in a manner that what's in it for me. That is the incorrect way of approaching the scriptures. It is a holy book. My book even says on it, Holy Bible. It's holy. It's not a come and get it. It's holy. 2 Corinthians 5:10, just to continue with this a little bit, says we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. That's scary, isn't it? So that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body. Ouch. According to what he has done, whether good or bad. Wow. So we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and each one of us is going to give an account for what we've been given. All our material gains, it's all worthless. Worthless. God will not commend us on how well we run our business or what nice house we have. That's not in the interest of God at all. He gave you seed. Remember the parable of the talents? Sometimes we need to go back and read it. But Paul here is reminding them, his main thrust is to remind them of the future. Here in Corinthians, as well as what we're reading now in Galatians. God will require evidence of the seed, the Holy Spirit. Has he not placed the Holy Spirit inside you? Yes, he has. The Word of God, has he not placed that inside you? Yes, he has. That was placed in you. How have you used it? That's what he's going to say. I gave you my Spirit. I gave you my Son. I gave you the Word. What did you do with it? No one's going to answer for you, by the way. Your mum's not going to be there standing behind you. So, No, you're going to be there, and God's going to be in front of you. No one can answer for you. Yeah, but. There's no yeah, buts. Did you live your life for him? Did you live your life for his kingdom? Did you sow your gifts and your talents that he gave you into his things? Or did you live for you? Did you live for you and your gains on this earth? My house, my car, my everything, my empire. Mark 8:36, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? You're going to live forever. Your body won't. But you are, the person inside, your spirit will live forever. And that forever can be in heaven or it can be in hell. That's what the Bible teaches. God has invested a lot in you. He gave his son for you. And he gives you more. Then we have the audacity to say we want more. I want more. Christ, that doesn't have any value to you at all. That you want more. That you've been born again. You've been saved from the love of God. You were dead, but now you're alive and you want more. Is that not a cause for repentance? I believe so. It's a sin against God. It's like saying, Christ is not enough. I want more. To have all this world has to offer and yet to not have Christ, well, that's to be eternally bankrupt. All the world's goods will not compensate for losing one soul in eternity. You can be a multi-millionaire, but it's not going to get you into heaven. God has instructed us through his disciple Paul, as well as elsewhere in his word, to please the Holy Spirit instead of the desires of the flesh. In this way, we will reap the heavenly rewards that neither rot nor be taken away. Matthew 6:19-21. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures of earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, but where thieves do not break in and steal. And there's your crux. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where's your heart? There's our application, right? Where's your heart? Is your heart on the things of God, the kingdom of God? On friends and family members that are going to hell because they don't know the gospel? Is that where your heart is? Praise God if it is. Is your heart for people out there that are just completely lost and living in a wicked, evil world to spread and tell them the gospel and the good news of Christ regardless? Or is your heart on building your own kingdom, building your own empire? Look how great I am. Look what I've done. Is that where your heart is? Don't be misled. You cannot mock the justice of God. And you will always harvest what you planted. Those who only live to satisfy their sinful worldly nature will harvest decay and death. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life in the Spirit. That's us. We're the sheep. The sheep hear his voice, yeah? So we, obviously, sow to the kingdom. We will reap from the kingdom. Glory to God. Hallelujah. That's something to be pleased about. Verse 9, Galatians. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. How can one persevere in doing good things? There is only one way. Only one way. And that's by continually relying upon the Holy Spirit, not upon yourself. Relying on yourself is works. Paul's just been coming through all the chapters before him about that. But as you probably experienced, as we all have, doing it that way is tiresome. It wears you out. I think the words we use will be stress. It stresses you out, exhausts you. And actually, 9 times out of 10 turns to nothing. Everything was pointless. Because he may have had great intentions, but what's that old saying? that unto her always paid with good intentions. We may have had good intentions, but we tried to do things in our own strength and our own what we thought was a great idea, but it wasn't led by God. If we're Christians, we're supposed to be led by the Spirit. And then we end up getting worn out. And most times out of 10, these are the people that start drifting away from church, drifting away from fellowship, because, well, God hasn't come through for me, has he? You've got to allow the Spirit to produce the good in you and through you in your life. And this is what it means to walk in the Spirit, live by the Spirit. This is what it means. We may never witness or see the results of being good, doing good things. Whether that be sowing financially, we sow financially as a fellowship, we give to missions. We don't know what the outcome of that's going to be. We don't know. But we do get reports on what goes on, but we don't know the long-term effects. That by giving just a little bit, it allows our missionaries to do what they need to do. By prayer. Are you pushing in prayer? What if you stop praying? By helping someone in need. And we cannot and we should not give up. And that's what Paul is saying. Don't give up. Don't tire. Don't get worn out. The Holy Spirit will provide you with the energy and with the strength. You may be the only person, you know, that's praying for a family member or a friend. What if you give up because you think your prayers aren't getting heard? Then no one's praying for you. You may be one of a few that supports a ministry, a pastor, a teacher, or like we just said, missions. What if you stop? What if someone else stops, all of a sudden that ministry finishes? They need financial support. Bills have to be paid. It's God alone and God alone who determines the due season, not you. All this rubbish that you may have picked up in the past, and certainly I have, if you sow your money here, then you're going to be. And your due season is now. Do you remember that one? I've been told that a few times. I've had people go, and your due season is now. You're going to reap the benefits of your harvest. 20 years ago, and I'm still waiting. It's a long season, man. Rubbish. God determines the due season. Yeah. Not circumstances, not situations, but he who is sovereign over all creation. Now, Paul has been reminding the churches in Galatia. Remember, he told them how well they started. You ran well, he said, didn't he? He told them also to uphold and support one another through fellowship and with one another. Basically, he was saying, keep going. Don't faint. Don't get involved in the law. But walk in the Spirit, live in the Spirit, and you will keep going. Because he provides you the effort and the power and the strength to keep going. It's not of your effort, then, is it? It's of his. And he provides what? Seed to the sower. You see how this all works? It's all about him. Keep going, guys. You know, even simple things, our words can encourage one another. Our words can encourage those who are burdened. How much an encouraging word can change someone's day? Just a word can change your day. That's something. Proverbs 12:25. Anxiety in the heart of a man causes depression. But a good word makes it glad. Praise God. Proverbs 15:23. A man has joy by the answer of his mouth. And the word spoken in what? In due season, one says, how good it is. How good it is. A word spoken at the correct time, how good it is. So someone who's walking in the Spirit. You don't know who you're going to meet in heaven one day. And they may come up to you and say, you told me, you encouraged me. I was about to do this, but you said, hey, stick with this. You encourage them, you help them. You cannot give up. You cannot give up. And when we walk in the Spirit daily and being taught by the Lord, we know how to speak the word in due season. sown, we will reap, whether that's good or bad, in his time. So let's conclude. We've got an application, but we've also already got an application too. We don't know the plan of God in advance. He doesn't write it out for us, but he does. He's given us revelation. But we don't know the personal plan. But from our perspective, we are presented with a series of opportunities which basically demand a good, godly response. We are to be alert, we are to be eager to act when the opportunity comes. And to be thankful to God for making us willing to see everything through to the end in his strength. In our own hearts, there should be a settled intention to do good when that opportunity comes. We do not need to awaken ourselves as if we've forgotten the gospel of Christ. We shouldn't be two-faced. We shouldn't be two people. We shouldn't be a Jekyll and Hyde. God knows. And so do people. If they see two different people, one person in a church on a Sunday, another person at work on a Monday, you know what they're going to be impressed by. Not going to be impressed by church at all. They're going to know the person they see on the Monday. It's not hard to do good, is it? It's not hard to do good, especially if it becomes a habit, if it's habitual. But if our own affairs are our highest priority, then we'll have little or no capacity to help others. For our help will be limited to what does not inconvenience us. No application. Someone needs help, can't be bothered. Maybe they'll go away. Because it's inconvenient. We may fool ourselves into expecting that we sow a little, but we expect much. We can't fool God, and the results of our poor sowing will be totally evident. If you're not growing in your fruit as a Christian, then you're probably not sowing in the kingdom, as you should be. Those who live for themselves are living according to the flesh. Paul's made that quite clear. You're not living in the spirit, you're living in the flesh. In contrast to those who are living sacrificially for the sake of others and for the glory of God, are walking in the spirit. Yeah, we get tired, get weary, we get burned, but we keep walking. We keep going. We often see, actually, throughout the scriptures, our wallet is a wonderful indicator of which kingdom we serve. Whether we serve the kingdom of self or the kingdom of God. This is a bit of a hard message, but it's the truth. And in Galatians 6 here, we're told to materially provide for those who teach. If you benefit from the instruction of someone, then you should support them. Support the church, support the ministry, support the mission, and everything else. So, ask yourself this question. Do you gain benefit from your church? Do you gain any spiritual benefit at all from your church? If so, are you supporting it? Are you supporting it as you could, as you should? That's for you to answer. Bills need to be paid. And we can see now how the flesh versus the way of the heart will play out in this area. The one who feeds his flesh will take the instruction, will benefit from the help, but never think about providing for the one who has benefited him. But the one who sows in the spirit, he's the one who will share all good things with those who teach. And that is why Paul says what he says in these verses 7 and 8. In the forefront of his mind is how we sow and how we reap in financial matters, but it is so much more. Financial matters are only one way to apply this principle. What Paul is really wanting the Galatians to see is the big picture. And that is the picture of the eschatological reward and the judgment that's going to impact our lives, our fundamental of giving. And so for the context here of Galatians 6 and 7 and 8, it's really centered upon the question of whether we live according to the spirit or live according to the flesh. There's your big question. People love a reward-based system. We love that reward-based system. It's in our naturality. We love the principle that if I do good things, then I'll get good things back. We love that principle, don't we? Bad things are given to bad people, good things are given to good people. But yet, I'm sure you've experienced, you've done good to someone and received bad back. So it doesn't always work, does it? Galatians chapter 6, verses 7 and 8, is saying, as some prosperity teachers proclaim, it's not saying this, that if I sow spiritual seeds by, say for example, giving them $50 or 50 euros, then I'm going to reap a grand reward of 500. That's what they teach you. I've read many books that say that. Many Hines books, and I've never read anything at all by the Copelands or anything, but they all follow the same line. Put your $50 in and get 500 out. God's a great big cash machine. It's a lie, and it's deception. And Paul is here thinking in terms of finances, but it extends beyond that. He's talking about supporting the work of God, not supporting another jet plane or a car. God is not mocked, he warns. And in verse 8, it really helps us to see what is the main thing on Paul's mind. Let's just get back to verse 8 quickly. Is the word of God true? Yeah? Is every word of God from God, written by God, by the Holy Spirit? Yeah? Alright, so what does it say? But he who sows the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. So we've got a bat there. And so we never read before, didn't we, that he doesn't, he sows the flesh, will reap of the flesh. And then he says, but he who sows the Spirit will reap everlasting life. Paul is thinking, actually, in terms of final judgment. He's thinking in terms way, way ahead of giving the church 50 euros or whatever else. He's thinking about when you stand before the throne of God and he asks you to give account for the seed. Paul is looking way ahead. He's talking about the eternal reward. So this isn't saying do good in this life and get something good back. This isn't saying this is your best life now. None of that rubbish. You are sowing into the kingdom of God, which is eternal. That's what Paul's saying. Are you sowing into the kingdom of God? Are you sowing into something that's eternal? Or are you sowing into something that's temporal and fleshly? He's saying, don't be weary in doing good in this life. Because at some point, you're going to be rewarded. And you will be rewarded. God will not be mocked. God's not a liar. It's saying it's easy to become weary in doing good when people around you seem to be sowing bad things, seem to be being rewarded. Yeah, that's disheartening, huh? When you see all the evil people, and they seem to be doing great. Everything's going great for them. Their business is going great. Everything's great. Everything's wonderful. Their marriage is fantastic. Their kids are so good. That's what it looks like on the outside. Evil people prosper. Does not we get warned about that constantly in the Bible? But who's the judge at the end? God. Now, if you want to join with the evil people and prospering on this earth, then go ahead and do it. But also remember, you're going to be judged for it. If we walk in the Spirit and we live in the Spirit and we give things in the Spirit and we support the work of the kingdom in the Spirit, then God's going to reward you for that. So this context that he's been talking about of reaping and sowing, and the reason why I wanted to dig into this deep this morning is because I, myself and I know a few others, have had incorrect teaching on this for years. For me, probably 30 years. Incorrect teaching on reaping and sowing and due seasoning. And it's all been wrong. This is the correct context of what we're reading today. And it's nothing about financial gain and reward. Nothing. Nothing, 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 nothing. So we can put that to bed now. We put that in a box, fold it up, throw it away, and start reaping and sowing into the kingdom of God. And not expecting that God's like a genie that we give and he's going to go, ooh, there you go. You're a good person. You deserve that. It can't be detached from the greater context of Galatians. It's only through Christ and what he has done that we are able to live according to the Spirit. A life which constantly sows to the flesh is an indicator that one is not being basically transformed. They're not saved. They can't be, can they? Because their head and their heart is on the flesh. It's not on the kingdom of God. There is such a person, there's no valid reason to expect to hear, well done, my good and faithful servant, are they? God is not mocked. Good and faithful servant. Converse is also true. Those who are, by grace, sowing to the Spirit, have every reason to believe and hope that they will hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. That's our hope, through Christ. Christ alone, grace alone. Comes back to it all the time. So here's the thought. Think about this for a few seconds. If you were required to appear before the Lord's judgment seat in the next 5 minutes, what kind of fruit would you be able to show? What evidence of your sowing? Just think about that for a few seconds. Next 5 minutes, you're going to be dead in the body, in the flesh, and you're going to be before Holy Mighty God. And he's going to say to you, I gave you my word, I gave you my spirit, I gave you my son, I gave you life, I gave you breath, I gave you gifts, I gave you talents, I gave you family, I gave you friends. What did you give me? Hour on Sunday morning? Hour and a half maybe? I don't know. Maybe you can answer that one. Why do farmers plant seeds? Because they expect a harvest, otherwise they'd be stupid. I planted lots of seeds and not got no harvest, but maybe I'm just not a good farmer. A small decision to either do good or bad always will reap a much larger crop for joy or for sorrow. Some fool themselves since their present seed hasn't produced a bad crop yet. So consequently they continue down that same path, mistakenly believing that there will never be a harvest. How wrong they are. But unlike the crops of the field, which are gathered about the same time each year, there's no set timetable for the harvest. Some results come quickly and others will take longer. Are you trusting God? Are you really trusting God? Because if you really trusting God, then your due season will come. Don't fret, don't stress about it. It's hard for some of us to put that to one side after what we've heard for years and years and years and years. But it's the truth. God is in control. God is in control. And he won't be mocked. And we're all going to have to stand and give account. And that's what Paul is trying to say here. This is the big thing of Paul's letter. This part of his letter is gone from the overall churches and now he's speaking personally to the believer. Look after the ones who teach you. Be good to them. Help them. Support them. He's not asking for more than that. It's just being gracious unto one another, fellowshipping with one another, putting one another before ourselves. The whole thing is getting wrapped up now. And now he's talking about eternity. He's now bringing this in. Think about the future. Don't think about the the next year, 2 years, 3 years. I'm going to have this, I'm going to have that. We've lost four people this year already. Gone like that. Who knows who's going to be next? Could be one of us. Don't know. But that's the truth. Father, I just want to thank you and praise you for your word, because your word really does cut. And I thank you for that. It cuts straight to the heart. As it says, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. And it will divide. It will divide. And let it, I pray this morning, through your spirit, divide the flesh from the spirit. May what we've heard, may what we've listened to, because it is out of your word, it's the letter that your apostle Paul was writing to the Galatians, which just is relevant for us today, that we need to strip away the flesh. We need to dump the worldly desires and delights and all the trappings of this falseness that we live in. And it's evil. And get back to the real things, the true things, and the things of your word, the truth of your word. To walk and to live in your spirit, to give you the glory, to give you the honor, to give you the praise, to encourage one another, to come alongside one another, to support one another, to serve one another, and to reach out to those around us that are lost and give them the glorious gospel of Christ. And not just to keep it to ourselves or be embarrassed or ashamed of the gospel, but to be lights, to be spokespeople, to tell the truth, even when it hurts, but to be truthful. So we thank you, Father, for your word. We thank you, Father, that we know that your spirit is going to work within us, challenging us, even now. The challenge has started. Uncomfortable feeling. Oh, may we learn from that, and may we not just push it aside when we walk out the door. And may we stand firm in the word of God. Stand firm for you. We ask this in the name of the precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 Let's stand and sing one more song before we go.
Lift up your name, for you are holy.
there, His Majesty. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May His face shine down upon you and give you peace. Amen. And goodbye to everyone who joined us online. God bless you all. Have a good week.